If we can turn to the book of 1 Samuel, I believe this church should be busting out of the seams if you ask me. But I want to take us to 1 Samuel here today, chapter 17 and verse 26. You can stand in the honor of reading of God's word. I've shared a few things about Connor Conlon, a message he had also on David Wilkerson, a message he had on Facebook. I encourage you to watch those, to listen to those. One of those I think I might show either tonight or I'll show it tomorrow night at prayer meeting. I think it's very powerful. And this is not a time which we should just be playing church or just going to church, but we are the church. We are the church. And I have a message that the Lord has laid on my heart. 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 26. And David spake to the men that stood by him, saying, "What shall be done to the man that killeth the Philistine and taketh away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" And the people answered him after this manner, saying, "So shall it be done to the man that killeth him." And Eliab, his brother, his eldest brother, heard when he spake unto the men. And Eliab's anger was kindled against David. And he said, "Why camest thou down hither? And with whom hast thou left those few sheep in the wilderness? I know thy pride and thy naughtiness of thine heart, for thou art come down that thou mightest see the battle." And David said, "What have I now done? Is there not a cause?" And then he turned from him toward another and spake after the same manner. And the people answered him again after the former manner. I want to minister here this morning on the thought, on the subject, is there not a cause? Now, I know that a lot of people are out sick right now, and I realize that maybe they're at home and they're able to tune in. Maybe they're able to listen to this, and I hope they can, because I want everybody to hear this. If they can, I want everybody in the world to hear this, if they can. But church, I believe in this final hour, in this crucial final hour, I have to ask the question, is there not a cause? Is there not a cause? And I think that this is not the time for the church to lay down her weapons. It's a time for the church to find her weapons, dust them off, pick them up, and begin to learn how to use them once again. Because I know this one thing. The devil is not playing tricks. The devil's not playing around. Let me put it that way. I know he has his tricks, but he's not playing around. And I just have to ask the question here today. Is there not a cause? Pray with me. Father God, we come to you in the name of the Lord. I thank you, God, for your grace and your mercy. I'm asking, God, for the anointing, the unction to be able to preach and minister this word. Touch my physical body, Father God. Strengthen me, God. Give me the strength to be able to minister this word. Give us hearts that are attentive. Give us hearts that are hungry. Give us hearts that desire God, your truth, your word, and to do something with it, Father. God, may you be lifted up and you be glorified, and may you minister to us, and may we be pricked, oh God, and changed today. And we thank you, Father, as we ask in Jesus' name, amen and amen. And you may be seated, and God bless you. Thank you, church, so very much. But I ask the question again, is there not a cause? And many years ago, I had preached this passage, but I feel the Lord has laid this once again upon my heart. But this time, it's not the same message, although it's the same title, but a different message altogether. And I feel that through the years of ministry that I've learned so much than when I first began. And not that I am perfected, or not that I am perfect, because I'm not. I make lots of mistakes, and I know I need God to help me, and I need God's grace to get me through every day of life. But as far as living the Christian life and fighting against the powers of darkness and dealing with carnality in the church, I feel that God has brought me a great distance through the years, and yet there's still a great distance to go, and there is still so much to learn. And how many know that we're always learning in the grace and knowledge of God? We never come to the end of the totality of things. There's always learning and always progressing on with God. Now, during this time, Saul was the king of Israel, and Saul was man's choice, but we know that David was God's choice, and Israel was fighting against one of her common rivals, the Philistines, and it seems the Philistines are always getting in the way. The Philistines are a type of the enemy that opposes the child of God and opposes the work of God, and they're always trying to get in the way and hinder God in our lives, hinder God in our church, hinder God in our ministry. The Philistines had lined up on one side of the valley, and of course, the Israelites had lined up on the other side of the valley, and there was a mountain ridge on both sides, and there's the Valley of Elah in between them, if you can picture that in your mind. Goliath was the Philistines' representative, and he was a warrior who stood nearly 10 foot tall. Goliath was a skilled soldier, my friend. Listen to me. Goliath knew how to fight a battle, and Goliath knew how to win a battle. He knew how to fight. He was smart when it came to his opponent. Just as the devil walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. But there was no man on Israel's side to fight this giant Philistine. They were afraid and they hid because of fear. The most likely person to fight Goliath would be King Saul. But Saul would be more interested in his own reputation than he would be in the reputation of God. Now, there are a lot of Sauls in the world today. They are concerned more about their image than they are being obedient to God. There are people in ministry that are concerned only about their reputation. It's not that they really care about God. It's not really that they care about the things of God. To some, it's just big business. To some, it's just big money. It's just security and so forth. You have to understand that Saul's heart was focused on Saul while David's heart was focused on God. And how many know this morning that there is a difference between Christ-centeredness and God-centeredness or self-centeredness, can we say? Saul would have good beginnings, but then later in his life he got off track, my friend. Goliath would come out day after day and defy the God of Israel. And this went on for 40 days. The Bible said morning and evening he would come out and defy Israel. And still nobody from Israel's side would come and fight this giant Philistine. Until one day Jesse asked David to take some food to his brothers who were at the battle. And when David arrived at the battle, he met his brothers there that were there. And he saw Goliath come out once again and challenge Israel to fight. And when he did, all the men of Israel ran from him because they were afraid of this giant Philistine. And when David saw Goliath coming out and defying the armies of Israel and of God, something rose up within him. Something stirred on the inside of him. Something disturbed him. This Goliath, understand, did not settle well with David. In fact, it bothered him. And I believe that David was vexed in his spirit. He was vexed in his heart. He was vexed in his heart, his soul. And I believe that a righteous indignation rose up within him. He was distraught that this giant Philistine, this enemy of God's people, was being a reproach to Israel. You know, it would be good to see Christians get distraught about some things these days. Come on, church. Rather than compromising our faith or giving into everything or going with the direction of the world, it would be good to see God's children become distraught today. For instance, being distraught over sin, amen, instead of giving into it, get angry with it. Don't pet it. Don't think it's your friend. Don't think that it's your pal. No, my friend, we ought to get angry with it. Sin is not our friend, but sin is our enemy. It's the Philistines, if you know what I'm talking about. Goliath is not our friend. The world is not our friend. The devil is not our friend. It's an enemy of God. But I want to ask the church today, where is the holy anger of God today in the church? Where is the holy anger today? Holy anger against ungodliness. Holy anger against wickedness. Where is the holy anger against worldliness or immorality or debauchery? See, our spirit within us should be vexed by what's going on these days and what we hear. Instead of casting out that which is threatening us, we now have allowed it to move in, amen, with us. We've become friends with that golden calf. Everybody else was worshiping that golden calf. But Moses destroyed it. Oh, may there be men and women of God today that arise up and say, thus saith the Lord, and that is wrong. I know that we're living in a day where people will say, well, that's judgmental. Jesus said, you'll know them by their fruits. Amen. Listen, my friend, I'm not judging. God is the judge of all, but I know what is sin, and I know what is not sin. I know what is God, and I know what's not God. I know what the Bible says, and I know what the world says. I know what God says, and I don't know what that devil says. But I tell you, we need a people that will rise up today and say, thus saith the Lord, I'll live for God. I'll serve God. I'll not worship that golden calf. I'll not bow down to it. I'm not giving it to Nebuchadnezzar, but I will serve Almighty God. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, my beloved, When the Philistines show up at your door, kick them out and say, you don't belong here. Come on now. When Goliath shows up on your cell phone, you kick him out and you tell him, you don't belong here. When the devil shows up on your television, you throw him out and you tell him, you don't belong here. When the enemy comes in like a flood, why don't you raise up a standard against it? Don't play with sin. Get rid of it in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Glory to God. Thank God we have the mighty name of Jesus. Thank God we have the Word of God, the sword of the Spirit. Thank God we have the blood of Jesus. Thank God we can go to the Lord and we can go to God with confidence and boldness because of the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Thank God. Thank God that we can. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen is right, sister. Amen. Now, if you will, let me bear with you what's on my heart, as if this were the last message that I would preach to you. I want this church to understand that time is running out. The days are evil. People's hearts are waxing cold because of sin. And let me tell you, church, that over the years, I've seen this more and more. It's getting worse as the days go on, but there's a deadness in the church. There's a dryness in the church. There's a powerlessness amongst Christians these days. And we are in church and we sing songs of praise, but there's a problem with our hearts growing cold towards God and towards spirituality. Let me tell you this. I'm going to be real honest with you. Maybe some of you are watching by the internet. That's wonderful. We're glad to have you. But we know how to play church. We know how to have talent. We know how to perform productions. But the church has lost its real appetite and its hunger for God. The church knows how to perform. It knows how to pretend. It knows how to look religious. But she lacks the true, genuine power of God. She can sing songs and yet be lukewarm in her heart. She can shout praise God and yet be silent on sin. She loves to talk about the love of God. She loves to talk about the grace of God. She loves to talk about the mercy of God. But she stays away from sin and repentance because it's too offensive. She can stage a big production and yet Jesus is standing outside the door knocking, desiring to come in. With the natural eyes, she looks perfect. Most don't see it. They can't catch it. With the natural eyes, she looks polished and faultless. But inside, Jesus knows that she's wretched, poor, miserable, blind, and naked. Jesus knows that the church, that she's void, that she's empty, she's lifeless, she's miserable. Yes, most people have lost their joy. The scripture says, but she who lives in pleasure is dead while she lives. She looks alive, but she's alive in name only. We have problems staying awake because our spiritual appetite has diminished. No hunger pains. Our minds are so distracted over every little movement. We think that we've heard it all, but we're not doing much with what we do have. God spreads a meal before us, but we pick and choose what we want to eat off the plate. And the church has fallen asleep at the wheel, and yet it's heading for a cliff. And she's got to wake up before it's too late. Now hear me, my brothers and my sisters in Christ, because there are a lot of people that will disagree with me. I'm not saying that you'll disagree with me, but I can tell you there is a church world out there that will absolutely disagree with me. But I know that I tell you the truth. We're more concerned about our comforts than we are of souls going to hell. We're living for ourselves rather than sacrificing for the gospel of Christ. Paul said, it's no longer I that live, but Christ that lives in me. And most can't say that. I'm not even sure that I can say that. Maybe we should say, it's I that live and no longer Christ that lives in me. See, wolves have come in dressed in sheep's clothing to destroy the work of God, and yet most people don't take notice. Imposters come in as an angel of light, and they have good personalities, and they have knowledge of the Bible, and yet they go unnoticed because most of the church is sleeping. We have an unbalanced doctrine of grace. If you only talk about God's love, if you only talk about His grace, but never talk about the judgment of God, then your doctrine is unbalanced. It is tainted. It is polluted. It is not the true gospel of Christ. And I implore you, amen, if there's no conviction in it, you need to run from it as fast as you can. There are people that run from conviction. I know they call conviction condemnation, but it's not condemnation. Amen. When God is trying to draw your heart, when God is trying to deal with your heart, when God is trying to work in your heart and your life, that is not condemnation. That is conviction, my friend. And it's good to allow the Holy Spirit to have His way. Let the Holy Spirit work in your life. Thank God for a church or a pastor or a preacher, wherever they are in this world, that preaches the true, genuine Word of God. Thank God for conviction. I know it doesn't feel well at the moment, but I know it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness. Thank God for it. Hallelujah. It proves that you belong to God. It proves that you're a child of God if God convicts you. Amen. We're more concerned about our fellowship than we are for reaching souls for Jesus. We're more concerned about our next meal than the soul that just went to hell. I just Googled this morning how many people die in the world daily. The average rate is 155,520 people die every day worldwide. And I wonder how many of those people went to heaven and how many of those people went to a lost and dying hell. 155,520 deaths per day. And I wonder, are we truly concerned about the lost? Are we really concerned about souls going to lost and dying hell? Listen, my beloved, I'm not specifically talking about this church or any church in that matter, but the church in general, the Christian church in general, Christians in America. What are we doing with Jesus? Now, I'm trying my best to minister this today. But I think that part of the problem is this, is that we no longer understand what we're fighting for. I want to lay this out here today. I think we no longer understand what we're fighting for. We no longer see the vision. Without a vision, the people perish. We don't know who our enemy is, and many are ignorant of his devices. I remember my son Michael told me years ago when he joined the Marine Corps that you have to know who your enemy is. You have to know what you're going after. You have to know what your mission is and who to target. And folks, I can say this with a broken heart, that the church has lost her mission. She's listening to too many voices, and she's going in too many man-made directions. Jesus gave us the mission very clearly in the Great Commission. And He said to preach the gospel to every creature and to make disciples and to baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Jesus came to reach souls for the kingdom of God, to snatch people out of the hand of the enemy, to forgive and to bring eternal life, to give life and life more abundantly. The Scripture says the kingdom of heaven suffers violence and the violent take it by force. But we have to understand and realize that this is a real fight. It's a real war and it's a spiritual warfare. And the devil is taking this more serious than the majority of Christians these days. And he's trying to do all that he can to steal and to kill and to destroy. And the church is getting mad because somebody is sitting in my pew. Someone is sitting in my spot. Do you see what I mean? Now, David was appalled at what he was seeing and what he was hearing. Now, here's a nobody. He's a shepherd boy. The least one that anybody would look at to do anything for God. On the back hills of Israel, tending his few sheep, his brother said. His flock. Must have been important to David. Must have been important to God. But David was appalled. His dad, his father Jesse, told him to take some food. Take some cheese. Take some bread. To your brothers, and then come back and give me word of how the battle is going. And so David, when he got there, he heard and he saw, and he was appalled by what he heard and what he saw, and he couldn't believe it. David knew God, and he knew that this was not right. He wasn't about to let this one slide. Get this, David had no one that believed in him. In fact, they tried to discourage him. His own flesh and blood, his own brothers tried to discourage him. And they said this, why did you come down here? And with whom have you left those few sheep in the wilderness? I know your pride and the insolence of your heart. They didn't encourage him. And then even Saul said, you are not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for you are a youth and he a man of war. I want you to get the picture here. He's a young man. And he goes and he hears this Philistine and something rises up within him. Now he gets no encouragement from Saul. He gets no encouragement from his brothers. I mean, at least his brothers could have said, hey man, I'm with you, David. You've got this. You can do this. I've got your back. If you go, I'll be right there with you. I'm with you. It's going to be okay. God is with you. You're not alone. But nothing. No help, no prayer, no support, no encouragement, no blessing. But just negative talk, speaking death rather than life. Now, I want you to notice, now, if you can picture that Israel being the Old Testament church, and Saul didn't encourage him, who was supposedly a leader, the king of Israel, didn't have enough faith to believe God, and David's brothers did not encourage him. They also did not have enough faith to believe God. So here you have someone rising up that God's hand is on, God is called, God is using, God's anointed. And you can't get others to have enough faith to encourage him. Now, I wonder how many times we as Christians put each other down rather than lifting each other up. I wonder if we also discourage our brothers and sisters in fulfilling God's call in their life because we are jealous. I wonder if we don't want others to be used of God. We don't want others to be happy in Jesus because of jealousy. It destroys and hurts rather than edifies and builds up. And rather than being happy for somebody that's being used of God, we're jealous because God's not using us that way. Or because it seems that things are happening for them and things aren't happening for us. And it can happen to the best of people. Jealousy. And so therefore we're not helping them. We're not supporting them. We're not praying for them. And so forth. But instead we'll talk against them. Now, David had something that many are missing today. Let me tell you what he had. This young man had faith. Let no one despise your youth. This young man had faith. He had courage. He had conviction. I see in his life that he had boldness, he had focus, he had vision, he had a fight in him. I love this. Now listen to me, my beloved. When we step away from God, when we move away from the purpose of God, when we move away from the call of God, not only do we lose our focus and vision, but we lose our fight. Amen. Come on. We lose our fight. We're no longer engaged in the battle. We don't see the need to fight, but instead we're hiding because of Goliath. Now, David had the fight of God in him. Israel belongs to God. They're God's people. And this is the Old Testament church, if you will. And the devil's not going to have his way. The devil is not going to destroy my church. The devil's not going to destroy my marriage. The devil's not going to destroy my family, my kids, my ministry. He's not going to do it. Now, I want you to listen to David. He said this. He comes to the battle. He's sees Goliath, and he says this, let no man's heart fail him. Because of him, your servant will go and fight with this Philistine. Now notice that David had this fight in him. I love it. By himself. He wasn't trying to show off. He had this fight. And when David was telling Saul of how he destroyed the lion and the bear, he said this. Now notice this, he said, and I went after him and smote him. Hallelujah. Oh, let me tell you something. The devil has been chasing after too many Christians today. It's time for the child of God to rise up in the mighty name of Jesus Christ and start chasing after the powers of darkness. Hallelujah. It's time that we start believing God and his word. Hallelujah. When the lion comes in to attack, you smote him. When the bear comes in to attack, you smote him. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. David had fight. 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 And he told Saul, he said, I went after him. Now, there's something about our spiritual youth. There's something about when we first are saved, that we have this faith. We believe God for anything. We'll believe Him for healing and for revival and for power and for souls. We believe God. There's a fight in us. And David had his youth. He believed God. And I love it. The fight when you're first saved. And I have to ask the question, where's the fight now? David had this fight, but where's the fight? Saul didn't have it, but he should have had it. David's brothers didn't have it, but they should have had it. All the church of Israel should have had it, but they didn't have it. Everyone was afraid and didn't know what to do. Some folks have quit the fight. Some have bowed out of the fight. Some have thrown in the towel. But one young man who believed God outshined all of them. One young man who had faith. One young man who held to the word of Almighty God. One young man who had experienced God in his life. One young man who was the least expected to be anything for God outshined all of them. Listen, my beloved, Goliath might have looked big and strong, and he was. But he's, listen to me, he was big, he was strong, but he is no match for the power of Almighty God. Hallelujah. I want you to realize that. Amen. I know the devil tries to look big and strong, but the devil is no match for the power of Almighty God. Greater is He that's in me than he that's in the world. Hallelujah. We have the power of Almighty God. We have the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Hallelujah. Praise God. I know the devil, Goliath, will try to come breathing down your neck, telling you a bunch of lies, but they're lies. The devil cannot tell the truth. He's the father of lies. But Jesus Christ, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Hallelujah. And when the devil looks at you, he doesn't just see you, but he sees Christ rising up in you. Fight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. I know we look big and strong, but God's bigger. David had the eye of the tiger on his countenance. He had the look of fight. He had the determination to fight. He had the faith to fight. Hallelujah. David was saying to Saul, let me at him. He wasn't being cocky. He wasn't being prideful. He was misjudged. He was misaccused. But he was saying, I've seen God work in my life before. God was with me before. By golly, God will be with me again. And David was saying, Saul, I don't need your armor. Let me at him. Oh, I got to take a drink of water in a minute. He said, I don't need your armor. It has not been tested. It has not been tried. I can't move around in this thing. He said, but there's an armor that I know that works. Hallelujah. It is the armor of God. And my friend, you have the armor. I have the armor. We have access through Jesus Christ. Put it on. 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 Hallelujah. What I'm trying to tell you, some of us have put away our armor. Some of us put away our sword. But it's time to rise up and put it on. Take the sword and fight. Fight. Let me at him. Let me tell you, the devil has been chasing you. He's been chasing this church. He's been chasing your pastor for over a year. Enough is enough. Enough is enough. Enough is enough. I'll rise up in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Some have been deceived. Some have been pulled away. But enough is enough. I'll take the Lord. I'll believe God. I'll hold on to Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 And the devil is trying to scare us. And the devil is trying to put fear in us. And he's trying to cause us to run away from Goliath. David said, listen, let me at him. Hallelujah. Let's get the fight back in us. The devil, you will not have this church. You will not have these people. You will not have these families. You will not have these children. You will not have this city. Fight. Fight! Hallelujah. Glory to God. I want you to get this. that I have been just struggling to survive. And in that struggle of just trying to survive over the year, I forgot some things. The anointing has to be sought after. We have to fight on our knees. We have to fight in prayer. We have to fight in seeking God's face. But I want you to know that David had two prerequisites for successful Christian living. He had this. He had vision and he had passion. David had vision and he had passion. And you need those two things, I know for sure, for Christian living, successful Christian living. Jude said, contend for the faith. In other words, fight for the faith. Fight for the gospel. Fight for souls. Fight for what you believe in. Fight for your family. Fight for your church. Fight for your kids. Fight for your home. Fight for your husband. Fight for your wife. Fight for your marriage. Fight for the truth. Some of us have lost our fight. We don't believe anymore. We're no longer fighting for souls, no longer fighting for kids, no longer fighting to bring people out of bondage or drugs or addictions or sin. We've lost our fight. Devil trying to keep us and knock us out of the ring, but don't you do it. Stay in and fight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hold on, church. Amen. I lost my shoe. Help me now. Amen. Put them shoes on, church. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Put on the shoes. Amen. And fight. Praise God. I can tell you that Jesus hasn't given up on the fight. Maybe some other people have, but my Lord hasn't. He's not slack concerning his promises, not wanting any to perish, but that all should come to repentance. God wants us to fight. He wants us to believe. He doesn't want us giving up on the cause. Amen, folks. Is there not a cause? That's what David said. He got over there. He said, why aren't you fighting this man? What's going on? 40 days and 40 nights. Everybody's afraid. David says, is there not a cause? Oh, yes. Is there not a cause? Amen, church. What are you doing about it? Let me ask you, are you just trying to get by? Are you just going to be the humbug Christian? Are you just going to be the mediocre kind of believer? Are you going to let Goliath ruin your family? Are you going to let Goliath ruin your marriage? Kids, are you going to let him ruin your home, your church, your ministry? Are you going to sit around and let the devil just do what he wants to do? Or are you going to rise up like David and fight? Amen. Is there not a cause? Are you going to let souls go to hell? Or are you going to fight? Are you going to let your kids fall in the hands of Satan? Or are you going to fight? Amen. Saints of God, let me ask you, isn't your marriage worth fighting for? Isn't your husband worth fighting for? Isn't your wife worth fighting for? Is there not a cause? Aren't your kids and grandkids and great-grandkids worth fighting for? Aren't your brothers and sisters in Christ worth fighting for? Isn't the gospel of Christ worth fighting for? Is there not a cause? Isn't the truth worth fighting for? Aren't souls worth fighting for? Jesus died for them all. Is there not a cause? Yeah. Oh God, help me. Let me tell you about some that were willing to fight. David fought for it. He was the only one who stood up to fight against Goliath. Not Saul, not his brothers, not Israel. David didn't have the experience. He didn't have the proper armor. He didn't have the support. He didn't have the encouragement. Basically, he stood alone. But David had God. See, that's the difference there. He had faith. He had confidence. He had conviction. He had God on his side. He had the Holy Ghost right there beside him. And God gave David the victory. That's God will give every child of God that puts their faith in Jesus Christ the victory. Hallelujah. David, amen, was willing to fight for it. John the Baptist fought for it. He gave his life for it. He prepared the path of the coming of the Lord. Make his path straight. He didn't back down when it came to Herod and his sinful lifestyle. He believed in the cause. He told the truth. Yes, he was taken to be absent of the body. Is to be present with God. But he believed in the cause. And he believed it even unto death. Paul the Apostle fought for it. He was stoned, put in prison, misjudged and shipwrecked, bit by a snake, fell among thieves and robbers. He fell among those who tried to do him much harm. False accusations and false teachers rose up against him, but Paul never backed down. Demas left his side, going back into the world, having a love for it more than a love for God. But let me tell you, he fought the good fight of faith. He believed in the cause. Nothing's going to stop him. Stone him, he's preaching. Put him in prison, he's preaching. Lock him up, he's preaching. Change him up, he's preaching. Whatever it is, he believed in the cause. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I know that Stephen fought for it. He died for his faith. Peter fought for it. They crucified him upside down on the cross. John fought for it. They exiled him to the island of Patmos. James fought for it. They murdered him. And Martin Luther fought for it when he nailed the 95 Theses on the door in 1517. He fought against the entire Catholic establishment. He was excommunicated in 1521. There was a bounty on his head. Why? Because Martin Luther believed in the cause. All glory to God. Hallelujah. You understand what I'm saying? Fight. Hallelujah. Fight. Fight. I think of Jim Elliot, a missionary that believed in a cause, who gave his life for tribal Indians in South America. Listen to me. These tribal Indians were nobodies from nowhere. The world hardly knew anything about them. But God places it on this man's heart to go down there and to minister Christ to them, because Jesus cares about them. He believed in the cause. H.B. Garlock and his wife Ruth went to Africa. Amen. Probably expecting not to return home. My white man's grave, they called it. But they went because they believed in the cause. A.N. Trotter, who did a great work for God, believed in the cause. David Wilkerson believed in the cause. B.H. Clendenin believed in the cause. Billy Sunday believed. Charles Finney believed. Charles Spurgeon believed. William Grinnell believed. John Bunyan believed. I could go on and on and on and on. Brothers and sisters in Christ that believe in the cause. Church, it's time to rise up. It's time to put on the armor. It's time to take the sword and fight, because we believe in the cause. Glory. It's time, brothers and sisters, to pick up your sword. It's time to pick up that shield of faith. It's time to put on the belt of truth. It's time to shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Put on your shoes. It's time. It's time to live it. It's time to believe it. Take hold of your slingshot and grab five stones and let's fight. We have a cause that's bigger than we are. We have a purpose. We have a calling. And so I call out to you, church, to fight. Fight. Fight on your knees. Fight in prayer. Fight. Fight with fastings. Fight. Fight with faithfulness. Fight. Fight and stand your ground and fight like Shammah. Fight. I'm not budging. I'm not moving. Devil, I'm coming after you. And I'm coming after you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I'm not coming in my name. I'm not coming in my knowledge. I'm not coming in my power. It's not by might nor by power, but it's by my spirit, says the Lord. I'm coming in the mighty, wonderful, matchless, glorious name of Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We have the Lord. We have His Word. We have the Holy Ghost. We have the shed blood of Christ. We have everything. Church, rise up, fight. Amen. Fight. Fight. Fight the good fight of faith. Fight against the powers of darkness. Fight against false teaching. Fight for the kingdom of God. Fight for souls. Fight for your loved ones. Fight for your church. Fight for your neighbors. Fight for this city. Fight. Fight. Thank you. Thank you. Hallelujah. I'm sorry. Help me, Lord. We quit the fight. Some have quit the fight. Lord, help us. We're not faithful like we used to be. We quit the fight. We're not on our knees like we used to be. We quit the fight. We're not finding that prayer closet anymore. We quit the fight. Amen. We're not faithful like we once were. We quit the fight. We quit the fight. Folks, listen to me. We need some Davids to rise up in this church. We need some spiritual Davids to take the sword of the Spirit. You take that sling. Pick up those stones. I'm going after Goliath. I'm going after the enemy of my soul. He'll not have my home. He'll not have my children. He'll not have my church. He'll not have my wife. He'll not have me. Fight! 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 Hallelujah. Oh, Lord God. Oh, God. Help us, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, I'll fight the good fight of faith. Hallelujah. 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 Fight. 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 Hallelujah. Fight. Jesus. Oh, God. Hallelujah. Oh, God, hallelujah. Oh, Jesus, hallelujah. Oh, mighty God. Fight, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. I'll stand on the promises of God that are yes and amen. I'll hold to the cross of Christ. I'll cling to the shed blood of Jesus. I'll hold to the mighty name of Jesus. I'll believe God. I'll hold to his word. I'll hold to God, to the testimonies of God. I'll hold to the truth. I'll hold to God. Hallelujah. Fight is what I'm saying. And God is saying the church is asleep. Rise up and fight. Rise up and take the sword of the Spirit and believe God, that with God nothing's impossible and God can do anything. He's all powerful. Believe, 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 believe. Hallelujah. Fight, fight, fight. Every child is worth the cause. Every person, every child, hallelujah, fight. Some of us have given up hope. Some of us have given up faith. Some of us have given up. We gave up on the cause. We gave up on the fight. We gave up on the vision. We gave up on the mission. We gave up. We throw in the towel. We gave up. And God is saying, it's not time to give up. Listen to me, church. I know, and you know, that Jesus can come at any moment, and I'm believing for the coming of the Lord. I'm looking. I want to hear that certain sound of a mighty rushing wind. I want to hear the trump of God and the shout of an archangel. I want to hear it. You better believe I do, and I'm listening for it, my friend. But until Jesus comes, until the rapture of the church, we're not to throw in the towel. We're not to lay down our weapons. We're not to give up, but we're to rise up and stand on the mighty word of God and believe. Being full of the Holy Ghost and power. Amen. Goliath, you don't have to worry about coming after me. We're coming after you. But we're coming after you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Don't tuck your tail under you anymore. You're not running anymore. You're not giving up anymore. You're not bowing down anymore. When the devil comes in and when Goliath comes knocking on your door, you answer it and say, Goliath, you're mine in the mighty name of Jesus. I'm coming after you. I know he tries to scare us. I know he tries to harm us. I know he tries to discourage us. He said a lot of things to David before he went engaged in the battle. But David says, listen, bud, you come with me in a spear and a javelin. I come to you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. You can have your carnal weapons, but they won't touch a flea. But if you have the name, the mighty name of Jesus Christ, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Oh, somebody help me today. Amen. We serve a great God, don't we? We serve a wonderful God. We serve an amazing God, don't we? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. God's so good. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Yeah, I love this. I love this. Mark chapter 16, and he said to them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. That's the mission and that's the vision. Now let us join it with passion. The passion of God. The Spirit of God rising up within us. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they shall cast out devils. In my name they shall speak with new tongues. Hallelujah. In my name they shall take up serpents, and if they drink anything deadly thing, it shall by no means hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and in my name they shall recover. They shall recover in my name. Lord, come on, church, pick up the shield of faith. The other day, I don't know what happened, but somehow our computer cord for the computer in the youth room came up missing. And Matthew went downstairs in my treasure chest of electronic devices and all the things that are history. And he looked for one and he brought it to me, but it didn't work. It didn't fit. And so I took it and I went back downstairs in the basement at home and I opened up that treasure chest of electronic devices, you know. And I'm digging through there and I'm trying to find, see if there's another cord. I thought I had another one, but I never could find it. But I'm going through that treasure of all these old electronic devices, and I pulled some of them and said, oh man, I forgot I had that. And the old saying is, out of sight, out of mind. You see, I forgot I had that. See, the church has forgotten she has some things. She's got to go downstairs and open up the old treasure chest, dig around in there, and she's going to pull out the shield of faith, and she's going to go, oh, I forgot I had that. She's going to pull out the breastplate of righteousness. She goes, oh, man, I forgot I had that. She's going to pull out the Holy Bible, the Word of God, which is the sword of the Spirit, and said, oh, man, I forgot I had that. It's about time I use it. It's about time I break it open. It's about time I put on the armor of God. Hallelujah. Oh, I forgot I had that. The helmet of salvation. I forgot I had that. The shoes of the preparation of the gospel of peace. I forgot I had that. The belt of truth. What I'm trying to tell you, go down in the basement, pull out that old crate, open up the box, and dig out those things that God has given you in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Wipe the dust off of it and put it on and fight. Put it on and fight. Put it on. Fight the good fight of faith. As I close today, I'm going to ask you, what was the cause? What was the cause? Let me tell you what it was and what it is. You. You. Because of these that believed in the cause, we're saved today. Because of these that believed in the cause, we have the Word of God with us today. Those that risked their lives to translate it into English so we can read it and have it in our hands. They believed in the cause. Who's the cause? You? You? Yes, we know it's the Lord. We know it's the gospel. We know it's the truth. We know, but David said that Goliath was a reproach to God and to Israel, to God's people. You. People laid their lives down for the sake of the gospel. But they laid it down for you and for me, so that we can be saved, so that we can hear the truth, so that we too can fight the good fight of faith and give her all for the cause of Christ, because we believe in the cause. Because others need to hear and others need to know about the saving grace and knowledge of God. There are people that are lost, homes that are broken and dysfunctional. Just, was it yesterday or the day before, someone came in and got fired in his job and opened up fire and killed five people, wounded others. One of the students, one person that was his first day there as an apprentice. One father had a baby and a wife. What's the answer? More therapy? More psychology? More pills? Is that the answer? No, let me tell you, my friend, and if you'll listen to me, the president of these United States, all of Congress, and the Senate, Democrats and Republicans, and all those mixed in between, the only answer is the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Only Jesus can change the heart. Only Jesus can forgive us of sins. God can take the heart of stone and make it a heart of flesh. Jesus Christ is the answer. Hallelujah. He died for our sins. He rose for our sins. And He's coming back for a church without spot or blemish, washed in the blood of the Lamb. The answer is Jesus. Friend,
amen.
If you're listening, your trouble, your anguish, your turmoil, the rage in your mind and your heart, the anger issues, wanting to kick the habit and bondage and drugs and sin and immorality, your answer is in the one who loved you so much that He died on the cross for you, that you might be saved and experience eternal life and experience the love of God, experience the peace of God. Mary Magdalene, seven demons, but delivered and saved, and now ministering unto Christ. The demoniac in Gadara, demon-possessed, cutting himself. But Jesus saved him and delivered him. And now he's sitting clothed in his right mind. And he's a follower of Christ. One true, amazing encounter with Jesus Christ can transform your heart and change you for life and eternity. He makes us a new creation in Christ. Praise God. Religion won't do it. Just going to church won't do it. You have to know Him. You have to have a life-changing encounter with amazing, wonderful Savior. His name is Jesus, and He loves you. And He came to set you free. Others fought, and they fought for you. They fought for you, for your soul. Are you worth it? Are you worth it? Are you worth all what these men suffered for you? Are you worth it? Are you worth fighting for? Are others worth fighting for? Is the gospel worth fighting for? Yes. 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 No one else would fight Goliath. Abby, if you'd come. So David said that he would do it. He said, I'll do it. I'll believe God. I'll rise to the challenge. But David, you're not trained. You didn't have proper Bible teaching and Bible preaching and classes. You're not trained. David said, I'll fight him anyway. Why, David, why? Because I love God and I love God's people too much to let this enemy of God have his way. I care too much. I'll go. Isaiah said, send me. Send me. He took the slingshot. He picked up five stones and he ran towards the enemy. The eye of the tiger. Let me at him. Devil, you'll not have my health. You'll not have my life. You'll not have my family. You'll not have my church. I'm coming after you in the mighty name of Jesus. You will not bring me down. I will not succumb to addictions. I will not. No, but I will live for my God. He put one of those stones in a sling. And he ran towards Goliath. And he let it go. That stone hit him right between the eyes. Fell to the ground. David didn't have any armor, didn't have a sword, so he came and ran and grabbed Goliath's sword. And he took that sword and he cut off the head of the enemy of God. And that's what Jesus did at the cross of Calvary 2,000 years ago. Hallelujah. We have the victory through Jesus Christ. Oh, praise God. David, God gave David a nobody. The victory. Glory to God. David asked, is there not a cause? Is there not a cause? Let's stand together. Is there not a cause, church? Is there not a cause? Oh, Father, we love you and we praise you with every head bowed, every eye closed. I just want to talk to you for a moment here, church. But you be real honest with yourself. Come on now, be real honest with yourself, because I've had to be real honest with myself too. But I believe that some of us have given up on the fight. Oh, you may go to church and you might sing songs and you might even be a part of ministry, but some of you have given up on the fight. You've laid down the sword, if you will. You've laid down some of the armor. And you've got to go back and you've got to pick it up. You've given up on the fight of prayer. You've given up on the fight of fasting. You've given up on the fight of seeking God. You've given up on the fight. Some of you, the devil is trying to scare. Some of you, he's trying to knock out of the ring. You've given up, but don't you give up. It's time to stand and fight the good fight of faith. Take the sword of the Spirit. Put on the armor of God. Believe the Lord by faith. Stand in the promises of God. Know who you are in Christ. Believe in the power of His name. It's time to fight, to fight, to fight. Some of us have to renew our passion. Renew our vision. Because maybe we've lost that. But I want to extend an invitation to you to come once again to this old-fashioned altar and to seek the face of God and ask God to renew the vision. Ask God to renew the passion. Ask God to put the fight back in you. God, put the fight back in me. Put it in me. Put it in me, God. Put the fight in me by faith. By faith. Put the fight in me. Put the fight in me. I'm talking about you personally, your personal life. Come on, church. I want to fight. God, put the fight in me. Put the fight in me. Put passion in me. Put the vision in me. Put conviction in me. Put it in me, God. Put it in me. Right now, I open this altar to you. Come, let's pray together. Let's believe God together right now. Let's believe the Lord together. Come on. Come on. Anybody willing to fight? Hallelujah. Anybody willing to do what David did? Take up and believe God. Believe God. Hallelujah. Don't let the devil have his way. Don't let the devil have his way. Don't let the devil have his way in your life. Don't let him have his way in your marriage. Don't let him have his way in your home. Don't let him have his way in your children. Goliath, you will not stay here. You do not belong here. When he comes in with temptation, kick him out. Take the sword of the Spirit and believe God. I'm going to call on the church to come and to pray for others that are at this altar right now. Come on, church, I need your help. Come and help me to pray. Please come help me to pray. We're fighting together. We're fighting with the same vision, with the same passion. We're fighting with the same cause. We are on the Lord's side. We are on God's side. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, fight. Fight. In the name of Jesus, fight. Fight the good fight of faith. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. I'm going after the enemy of my soul. He will not have his way. He will not have his way. In the name of Jesus, fight, sister. Fight the good fight of faith. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Fight, 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 fight the good fight of faith. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You're going to fight. You fight for your family. You fight for your children. You fight. You fight for your health. You fight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Fight, church. Believe the Lord by faith. Fight. Fight. My brother, fight. Hallelujah. The devil won't have his way in my life. He won't have his way in my home. He won't have his way with my child. He will not. We will fight the good fight of faith. We'll stand on the word. We'll believe God. God, put the eye of the tiger in him. Put it in him, God. Right here. The eye of the tiger. The eye of the tiger. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Fight. Fight. Fight the good fight of faith. Hallelujah. Fight against all opposition. Fight against Goliath. Fight against the powers of darkness. Fight. Fight. Hallelujah. In the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I believe. Help me, God, to be a David. To be a David. To believe. To have conviction. To have vision. To have passion. Oh, God, I pray. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Fight. 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 Hallelujah. Young man, fight. 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 Come on. Be a David. Rise up. Rise up. Fight.